In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title for the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been improperly or erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles, and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name, and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name for our Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested Himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that He walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, He instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where He showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim, as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of natures and powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose operating through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations in time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today we will have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. That will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson today will be Titus chapter 1, and that will be read by Dr. Eunice Reiser. Dr. Salas.
Good evening, class. It's a time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, Creator, the whole stellar universe, things seen and unseen. We are here to learn your purpose and plan of salvation through all the dispensation of time. Give us something to edify us like you've been doing, and that way we can become more fascinated and interested and willing to see your greatness, things you did for us to see you, if you are in reality and exist. I say all those things, and you only sign name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
I'm not afraid. Good evening, class. Our scripture lesson will be taken from Titus, the first chapter, page 286. And I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainum. Titus, the first chapter. Saul, a servant of Yahweh, an apostle of Yahshua the Messiah, according to the faith of the elect of Yahweh, and the acknowledging of the truth which is after righteousness, I hope to eternal life, which the Elohim, who cannot lie, promised before the ages began, but hath in due time manifest his word through preaching, which is committed unto me according to the commandment of Yahshua our Savior. To Titus, my own son, after the common faith, grace, mercy, and peace from Yahweh the Father and Yahshua the Messiah our Savior. For this cause left I thee in Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that are wanting, and ordain elders in every city, as I had appointed thee. If any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly. For a bishop must be blameless as the steward of Yahweh, not self-willed, not soon anger, not given to wine, no striker, not given to filthy lucre, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate, holding fast the faithful word as he has been taught, that he may be able to be sound doctrine, both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they are the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole houses, teaching things which they ought not, for filthy lucre's sake. One of themselves, even a prophet of their own, said that the Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, idle gluttons. This witness is true. Wherefore rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in the faith, not giving heed to Jewish fable and commandments of men that turn from the truth. Unto the pure all things are pure, but unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure, but even their mind and conscience is defiled. They profess that they know Yahweh, but in works they deny him, being abominable and disobedient, and unto every good work reprobate. I have read Titus, the first chapter. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Salas, and thank you, Dr. Reiser. So today I would like to open up the floor for anybody who would like to give a testimony before we get started with calling a speaker. So if anybody would like to do so, let us know. Yeah. Okay, so for our first speaker today will be Dr. Aaron Alanese.
Check, check. Who? All right.
Good evening. Good evening. always an honor to have a chance to stand up here and really share and give thanks to Yahweh for what he has revealed and shown thus far in my learning. The scripture that was read was awesome, and I believe it's Paul writing to Titus, because he left him in charge of finding leaders of the church, I believe, at the the leaders of the able-bodied ministers, and what to look for. But that was really, really nice. Just a little bit of a testimony for lately what I've been going through. I've been more actually relating to the story of Job and his tests and trials. And man, does it get hard out there. You're hit all the time out of nowhere. And to be able to give thanks during those times only shows the power of Yahweh that much more. And even the events, everything that happens points back to Yahweh. So the things that I learn here in class really help me out there in the world, though it's not just contained in this class, because you can go online and research anything that we say down here, and we actually encourage that to your satisfaction, and for your own good. But I do come down to this class, and this is where I do come at least 3 times a week, because I also like to hear what other people have come to learn, and to have a common seeking of the truth. And knowing that truth allows you to give thanks in those times when it's hard. Because though I'm experiencing personal stuff that's hard on me, I see a lot of other people experiencing even worse stuff, if you can put it that way. Their struggles, from my point of view, are a little bit more than mine, because I have peace during those struggles with in Yahshua. And it doesn't always feel good, but that's not what that's not our goal, is to feel good. Our goal is to get back to where we came from. Right. Mm-hmm. Back to where everything comes from. And that is pure spirit. And the last class we had went over that like phenomenally. That whole explanation was like, man, exploded my brain. Because though I've been coming down here when it was, and I've been told this many, many times, but just until recently did Yahweh actually gift me with a little bit of clarity of what this is, and to know who I am, and give me the foundation, or bring out the foundation that's always been there. And to have that foundation and calmness again while there's a storm going on around you is just so phenomenal. And you first start that kind of journey when you learn about these names and or this name and title. And that's usually where I try to start people and see kind of the kind of reactions I get when I tell them about, hey, do you know the name of Yahweh? Do you know? A lot of actually people have heard Yahweh. I'm actually very surprised because it was so new to me. In my carnality, I'm thinking, you know, everyone's like me. But no, I'm like, wow, I'm actually kind of behind if I think about it a little. But it's actually not because it's Yahweh's timing. So anyways, I digress. So this is actually being more and more common, the name, not the understanding of the name entirely, because I'll ask someone to maybe break it down, like, where did you get that from, or what, and they don't really know. But again, you could be told something, but until you have that understanding, until that understanding is gifted to you, you don't really know anything. And even when you do get that, you still don't really know anything. But if you diligently seek and you continuously push forward and with the foundation and understanding that Yahweh, out of love, came out of pure spirit in part, not in totality, because it didn't take the sum total of Yahweh and the attributes that we have depicted up here, the nine principal attributes, to create the creation. He merely willed into this super incorporeal form, transmuted into this super incorporeal form known as Yahweh Elohim. Never stopping to be anything other than Yahweh, but in a super incorporeal form, so he gave himself the title of Elohim. Mm-hmm. Now, super incorporeal seems like a, you know, really cool big word, but really when you break it down, all it means is it's, you can't touch it. It's and super is just larger than life, look big, mm-hmm. You know, bigger than big. Incorporeal though is, in this form, he had the shape of a man, but without flesh and blood. Shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. And once you start to understand that a little bit more, the foundation only grows. And the strength that's been in you the entire time only grows. And if I can say it, it activates in a way. Because once you have a little bit of understanding about the super incorporeal Yahweh, and you diligently seek more, you start to come to an understanding of who Yahshua is. and how the mystery of iniquity, purposed this way, has tried its damnedest to confuse, trick, and leave people in darkness by giving them a golden calf, if you will, to worship in its stead. Because people don't have, not everybody has an understanding in which to elevate them out of this old way, this idolizing of stuff that we don't understand. And then once you again diligently seek the truth, then the lies start to fall off. Mm-hmm. And you start to come into some truth as to who the real Messiah is. And how even he said in his own words, I come in my Father's name. And you can see that evidently, as plainly as the writing on the wall. That, look it, there's Yah right here, and there's Yah right here. Simple. It's actually super simple to the point that people try to make it complex and explain things to a confusing point as well. And it's like right here in front of your face is as simple as that. Like, I'll give you an example. The book of Numbers. You read it, it's exactly what it says it is. Numbers. It's giving you the counts of the tribes, giving you all these numbers. And it's sometimes as simple as that. But we come up with our own ideas based on our own concepts. And that starts to trip us up. But it's not the end all be all. You can, again, if you still diligently are seeking that, the truth, it will be revealed that Yahshua is Yahweh and Yahweh is salvation. And then it's easier, once the mud is scraped away, to see how this super incorporeal being can take on the likeness of sinful flesh, mm-hmm, and walk the earth plane as Yahshua, who has been here from the beginning and has not left and is diligently seeking you, for you to seek, and is diligently in your face every day. And you can't always see it because the mud's not always scraped away. But again, once it is, and you start to come into these little understandings, I say little because this doctrine has, or this teaching has so much to offer. And these are the steps, if you will, or the basic building blocks on which to have a foundation to go off into these other parts of it. But this is the main act. This is as much as it feels like it's basic, is almost all you need to know. That Yahshua died on the cross, ending and fulfilling all the cardinal ordinances, laws, and physical sacrifices, not destroying them and getting rid of them entirely, because he had to give us something physical to understand the spiritual. So he still kept it there for our edification. He didn't give it to us. He gave it, the commandment, Ten Commandments, and the laws, and the statutes and ordinances in the wilderness Sinai, when he spoke them down from Mount Sinai during Moses' first trip. And the Israelites, after leaving, after Yahshua led them out of the land of Egypt and out of captivity, while they were waiting in the wilderness, again, because they were following this cloud that was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And that's what led them. Notice Yahshua led them out. Pillar of fire led them out. Okay? Because it never stops being. During the first trip, Yahweh Elohim spoke down the Ten Commandments to the children. And they agreed to obey what had been spoken, making a promise or a covenant or a marriage. Now, that seems like they're, you know, peaceful, right? They were in, all right, we're out of captivity, we're in a whole new world. We have someone who protects us. Now we have a law to follow. Perfect, right? That's all. It's very basic. That's all you got to do. Just like when Moses had his first vision. Second trip, first part of the vision. Now, on that second trip, Moses was instructed to come up with Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and 70 of the elders to a certain point on the mountain, at which they saw Yahweh Elohim in a vision, because the children are still down here, and a super incorporeal being is, if it was physical, would be seen. If it was being shown, you could see it from probably everywhere. But Yahweh Elohim can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Now, visions are happening every day still. They're dreams. They happen in your head. It could be even a waking dream. As long as it's happening in here and you can be the only one seeing it, you can be in a room full of people and you could be the only one seeing this vision. Just like the 70 elders, Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, and Moses saw in this vision a super incorporeal being known as Yahweh Elohim. So, again, can only be understood in divine revelations. Can we get that Exodus 24? I think it's N9 where it says he didn't touch, but he touched. He laid not his hands.
Okay. Exodus 24:9. Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and they saw the Elohim of Israel. And there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone, and as it were, the body of heaven in his clearness. And upon the noble of the children of Israel he laid not his hand. Also they saw Elohim, and did eat and drink. Want me to go first?
No, that's good. So he laid not his hand. That simply means he did not give them the understanding. So they saw this being, but they did not understand what exactly they were looking at. So they were told to tarry here while Moses and his minister Yahshua Moses went into the cloud. Yahshua was already in there. Because he had transfigured into Yahweh Elohim. Transfigured? Transmuted? Transformed? Transformed? Okay, that's correct. Trans. but then Moses joined and went into this fiery cloud. And this thing was scary to.
Read it on down.
Okay, go ahead.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, come up to me into the mount and be there, and I will give thee tables of stone and a law and commandments which I have written that thou mayst teach them. And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua, and Moses went up into the mount of Elohim. And he said unto the elders, tarry ye here for us until we come again unto you. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. If any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them. And Moses went up into the mount, and a cloud covered the mount. Do you want me to go further?
Then that's good. So after Moses and Yahshua went into the cloud, Moses fell asleep. Or was put to sleep. And he's seen in a vision Yahweh transform into the tabernacle. And then this tabernacle, how do you put it? And then he saw the creation come out of, based off the tabernacle, because everything is threefold. Everything operates and functions, like it said in the moderation, by this tabernacle pattern. But at first he was just the pattern, and Moses didn't have. Didn't know exactly what was going on and how this was operating yet. But he did see the tabernacle, and then he saw the creation in 6 solar days. Because it didn't take Yahweh 6 solar days to make the creation, or didn't take Elohim 6 solar days to make the creation. It just took him 6 solar days to replay it for Moses and for his edification and understanding. And when he ended the 6th day, he saw Adam and Eve in the garden in peace. Mm-hmm. And then he came, and then... He was still, and then the remaining 33 days, he was shown the tabernacle pattern and its operation and functions. After those 40 days, 40 nights in the cloud, he came out. And upon coming out, Yahshua, his minister, told him, "I hear sounds of war." Now, to anyone else hearing this, it would just sound like a party going on. You can hear it just like sometimes late at night, if I keep my window open, my neighbors down the street like to throw a fiesta, and you know, they go until about like 3 a.m. sometimes, but that's cool because it's party. But that's kind of what it was. It was a sound of partying off in the distance, and to anyone else it would just sound like that. But to Yahshua, it sounded like war because he speaks spiritually, and he speaks to the spirit inside of everyone. Now, Moses wanted to get a closer look because, I mean, you hear war, it's just like a car wreck. You want to see what's going on. You just need to see the action. You need to... So he goes and sees this, and he waxes hot, and he's angry because he sees this golden calf, and he sees the children worshiping it and partying and celebrating and calling it their El, the one who led them out. Mm-hmm. Now, don't get me wrong, we've all had our shortcomings, but imagine this, you just got married, you had to go take care of some business, you come back, and your spouse is cheating on you. You'd be a little mad, wouldn't you? You'd be a little offended. Mm-hmm. And I mean, Yahweh was mad. Yahshua was mad too. Moses had to beg. Moses was like, "Please, please understand. Just come on." They didn't mean it. Aaron, I'll talk to him. And he said, "You can blot my name out the book. Just forgive them. Just." And he reminded Yahweh, and Yahweh remembered his promise. Now, that was all a show for them, because it was set up that way. Yahweh knew better. And knew that this is what he had to do to get these children to learn a little bit something. So Moses equally is angry because he just saw this beautiful vision, this beautiful beauty. But then he had to appreciate it. He had to gain some appreciation for this more than he had. Because don't get me wrong, he was probably like, "Wow, this is the greatest thing." But he had to have more appreciation, more solidifying. And he had to see the opposite of that. Mm-hmm. And he had to see the transgression without understanding the transgression. And when you have to watch something as damaging as say a cheating spouse, it causes anger. He or it causes frustration and lack of understanding will cause you to do things that you probably wouldn't. Moses broke the Ten Commandments. The stones. He shattered them. After he just saw all this, he watched them be etched into the stone. He's everything, and he has them in his hands. And most people would cherish these physical things, but this spiritual war that was going on was enough for him to just be like, "No, not today." And he came down and he destroyed this golden calf and just grinded it down to a dust. And Samuel just put me onto this and gave me something that pricked something in me to research this a little bit more. So thank you for this little part. But let's get the Exodus. Was it 36:27?
Are you talking about the golden calf?
Yeah. Or
32:26?
Yeah, around there.
Then Moses stood in the gate of the camp and said, "Who is on?" Oh, that's beforehand. Okay. Let not the anger of my sire grow hot.
Let me grab my, sorry.
What part?
This is really neat.
Where they had
Thirty-two and 20.
Okay. And he took the calf which they had made and burnt it in the fire and ground it to powder and strewed it upon the water and made the children of Israel drink of it. And Moses said unto Aaron, "What did this people unto thee that thou hast brought so great a sin upon them?" And Aaron said, "Let not the anger of my sire grow hot. Thou knowest the people that they are prone to evil. For they said unto me, 'Make us Elohim which shall go before us.' For as for this Moses, the man that brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we know not what is become of him."
See, and they're crediting still Moses, who saying that Moses brought them out of here. So even still, Aaron doesn't have that understanding enough to, and he saw Elohim. And he doesn't have that understanding to explain it to the children. Even Moses didn't have the understanding yet because he's seen a transgression, but he doesn't understand it. I just wanted to get, then we can go Deuteronomy 9:21. It's just about the golden calf real quick. It was really neat. So he ground it into powder, right? Mm-hmm. And I've heard this a couple times. So when I think of it, I think, you know, like they're standing in line and Moses is like measuring out scoops of gold and just throwing it in there. And it's like, all right, there's enough for you. Drink that. But this is what this is actually how he dispersed it.
Deuteronomy 9:21.
Is your mic on?
And I took your sin, the calf which ye had made, and burnt it with fire, and stamped it, and ground it very small, even until it was as small as dust. And I cast the dust thereof into the brook that descended out of the mount.
Into the brook There is only that source of water going to them. So they had no choice. He put it all along it. They had no choice but to drink it. That was the only source of water. And I just those little things are really neat to me. But so I digress a little bit. I know it went on a little tangent there, but that was really cool, and I wanted to point that out. So anyways, after seeing this, and after they were punished, and pretty much had to swallow their sins, Moses was instructed to hew out another set of stones in preparation for his third trip. Cool. And in this third trip, he saw a recapitulation of the first part of the vision, which he saw on the second trip, and he saw it up to the point where he left off, and then he got to see the rest and the transgression take place, and then the genealogies and the histories leading up to him and beyond. Now, after that, he saw again the workings of the tabernacle. And that pretty much completes the three trips. You can go a little bit more, but I ran out a little bit of time, I know. But again, I just want to thank Yahweh for giving me the opportunity to stand up here and say a little bit of something that he's shown me, and just to give thanks for the confidence, for the strength, for the power, for the love, for the foundation that he gives every single day and that he shows in every single way. And if you got anything out of what was said here on the floor during this time, all praises be to the only begotten Son, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say,
hallelujah.
For our next speaker, I would like to call the Dean of the Ontario Branch, Dr. Marlon Love.
Didn't bring it in. Okay. Let me know if I bring my bag in. Okay. You need. You can read.
Good evening, class. How's everybody this evening? Good. Enjoyed the first testimony that Aaron gave about the things he's experienced and the things he's come to learn about being in this great school. And this is what this school, I think our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, really amassed to set up is to help a person learn and know about their Heavenly Father, which is Yahweh. And we come to this school to learn to know that Yahweh, as Aaron expressed on the Moses chart there, that he, in part, by way of transmutation, created a super anthropomorphic being known as Elohim, which is invisible, not with flesh and blood. And we also understood by this school, if you can read John 1 and 1, go ahead and grab it so that we're, and whomever might be watching, can see that it's in the book, that there is a Yahweh, and that Yahweh was Elohim, right? And that Elohim was in the bosom of the Father. These are things that we cannot see, and these are things that, as Aaron expressed on the Moses chart, that he saw, correct? Mm-hmm. And then we're going to have an apostle named John write about the same thing in the beginning. Go ahead and read, please.
John 1 and 1.
Uh-huh.
In the beginning was the Word.
Now take note that Moses writes the first five books of our Bibles, known as the Law. And he also says, if you ran and grabbed Genesis 1 and 1, he also expresses in the beginning. Is that correct? Do we might have Genesis? I mean, it's the most widely read verse I think that anybody has ever read. Go ahead and just read it as it go ahead and read it as the holy name is fine.
Genesis 1 and 1.
Uh-huh.
In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. And Aaron expressed that people know this name, Yahweh, more even so now. And he's correct. It is surprising that so many people know this name. Very few know this divine title. Mm-hmm. Some are coming into an awareness of there's another son's name other than Jesus Christ, however spelt wrong or however they've come to know, like Aaron expressed, that they've come to know about these names in various forms and various ways, right? What we're speaking of now, back to John 1 and 1 in the beginning. Mm-hmm. Keep with the train of thought.
In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth, and the earth became without form and void.
I'm sorry, John 1 and 1 now. Okay. Because I'm just bringing that up to let us know, the reader know, that when Aaron spoke of Moses having written the first five books or written Genesis 1 and 1, he also said in the beginning, is what my point was, right? I mean, he's in the beginning because he having had seen this tabernacle pattern, and you have a half of Elohim here, right, in part. And what is expressed as that every day of the creation, he came back into himself, and then to the next day, and then back to himself, and then into the second day, and then back into himself. He's looking at it by way of a threefold tabernacle pattern, and I might get into how each of the six solar days or events that took place is set up in a threefold fashion. This gives us some pattern to go by to see that Moses is not just writing a fable. He's not writing anything willy-nilly. And he's not writing about how the exact method that the creation took form. Because as Aaron said, it was a moment in a twinkling of an eye that Yahweh willed it, and thus it was. Now Yahweh's giving, Yahweh Elohim showing Moses how that broke down in how it was delivered. It's not how the world was created, but in type by pattern, it does give us an awareness to be able to be to prove who Yahweh Elohim is. This is the purpose by which each of these six solar days were broken up in parts of threes, right? And so now we're going to go back to John 1 and 1 right. to pick up the Yahweh Elohim being in the bosom of Yahweh in the beginning, because it's Elohim that's going to be the first created. Go ahead and grab, find Revelations, I think 12 and 3. But go ahead and read John 1 and 1. Yep.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh.
Well, I just said the Elohim, the Word is Elohim. We have the Word or Son, correct? And we're having Elohim being in Yahweh. Read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
Okay.
All things were made by him.
Okay.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
In this form of Elohim, this super incorporeal being, as Elohim created the creation, right? And he showed Moses, when he was on top of Mount Sinai, how those days of creation broke down. Now keep reading.
In him was life, and the life was the light of men.
This is the light that was the light of men, all men. Read.
And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
See, this darkness is in a chaotic state, because that's how the world came in, as shown by Moses' vision. In the beginning, Yahweh created, and it was dark, and there was no light to be seen in this chaotic state. So that's Aaron expressed that to come into a knowledge and an understanding about your Heavenly Father is the light that lights every man when you know who your Creator is. You have instances when people are unfortunate situations when kids have to be adopted for some reason. They'll get older and they really want to know who their paternal parents are. Mm-hmm. Just a natural sense of the word. Not 100%, but a majority do desire who would be their natural parent, either a mother or either their father. It's an instinctive thing. So therefore, when we come and know, we want to know about God, most people express, what is God? Why does God put me in this situation? Why am I here on earth? Mm-hmm. That's a desire that they want to know about their father or their creator. Mm-hmm. Just as it manifested with an adopted child at birth. They want to know, you know, and besides, you know, a death or some other unfortunate situation. But if they had an opportunity to know, that's what they're going to want to do. And that's what we strive to do. That's that seeking our Creator. And in that, that's the light that we're going to learn about by knowing His name. Now you reread what you just wrote and then go down to 14.
5. And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
Now, there's no dark, and the darkness can't comprehend, can't understand the things of Yahweh. Therefore, the founder, having received the divine vision revelation, by way of Yahshua the Messiah, or the Spirit being in him, was able to amass these charts, put these Bible stories on charts, wrote 2 books, have transcripts of some of the 45 years that he preached the gospel until 1976, that we are able to go back to and learn of the things he spoke, right? In order to shed some light and information about our Father, our Creator, right? Mm-hmm. And we just said that Elohim, or Yahweh Elohim, created the world. Now, after you have the light, what happens with this light? Skip down to 14, please.
And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among
now
us.
Now, it's this Word, right, that's incorporeal, transformed, and became flesh, known as Yahshua the Messiah. That's what came into the world. In order to fulfill the things that were set up prior to his appearing. Everybody sees Mary and Jesus. You know, we just got through the holidays. And this is the extent of what they know about their father or their creator or their understanding about some God. And I say some God because, as in the moderation says, John 8:5, there's Lord's many and God's many. But which one are you speaking of? Mm. So that's why I express some God. Mm. But we're not talking about some God. We're talking about the God. The God of the universe, which is Yahweh Elohim, by way of Yahshua the Messiah, who came down into a physical body. And as Aaron said, he's been here this whole time.
Right.
Down through the ages and dispensations. Mm. In and out of a body, presenting himself to certain people, making certain things happen, vanishing before their eyes, and we have translated. Give me Enoch. Mm-hmm. I mean, a couple verses. Enoch 5:22 down to 24, and then you grab me 2 Kings. And Aaron said, the first principle of the school is to understand the unity, and this is what we're talking about by the names. Of the unity. We use John 1:1 primarily in order to get an individual to see the unity of the names, right? And how this name or this title Elohim, which is the word of son, manifested on earth as Yahshua the Messiah. This is the unity. And we can read 1 John 5:7 out of the King James Version. And we're going to talk about how these three are one. You can grab me that first. Because that's as Aaron said, there's a lot to the understanding that this teaching can shed light on with an individual's life. And it's through that understanding, as Aaron said, we will suffer things. We will go through and experience things. But how we endure through those things, with what information, with what light of understanding, that we can still our minds and be at peace within our world. Everybody has a different world. Everybody experiences different things, and everybody has a different. But the manifestation changes, but the principle of what we're talking about remains the same, and that's the same thing that Yahweh Elohim set up. This is why the principle of this pattern is threefold. And we want to learn about how this threefold tabernacle pattern. In order to bring a person from out of the state of darkness or a state of not understanding, state of curiosity, or a state of seeking, what is it all about? And we were expressed by, hey, number one, there is only one spirit. John 4:23, Yahweh is spirit, mm-hmm. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth, okay? And so when we understand that, that's the understanding of the unity, that we're going to read that now.
1 John 5:7,
mm-hmm.
For there are three that bear record in heaven.
See, many people would consider that's three distinct different beings, and we're expressing to you that it's just one. Read.
The Father.
Yes.
The Word.
The Word.
And the Holy Spirit.
Uh-huh.
And these three are one.
That's what we have in the name chart there, right? The Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and those three are one. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, by way of Yahshua the Messiah coming in this last part of the age, by way of Dr. Henry Clifford Kinney, is going to give us how to look at that as a unity and not as a trinity. Because you can read it in the law there in Deuteronomy 6:4 that he says that our Yahweh is a unity.
Right.
Right? And so now we have to understand by way of the law and prophets of what's set up to guide, to get some faith into what the unity is about, because we have a pattern that we go by.
Right.
It's a threefold pattern, but yet there's principles that we're going to need to use in order to point out the oneness of Yahweh, mm-hmm. and how there's not separate entities,
right.
or beings, right. as some may call it, right? And this is what's going to give us our strength and confidence. Go ahead and hit the translation of Enoch first, and see if we can bring it about this way. Because I enjoyed last class, as Aaron did, very much so too. And it resonated because I've been hearing in every other class I've been listening to. It is by way of the law and prophets. And we have to understand the law and prophets. I've already made mention that Moses wrote the first five books. Right? Mm-hmm. And we understand that the prophets constitute the second portion of the Bible. Isaiah 8:20. I'm sorry to have you grab mm-hmm. things, but I think this is important because we say it, but then we need to really emphasize it because this is how we learn.
Ready?
Yeah.
To the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word.
Go ahead and go up one verse above that. That's 19. Why. That's why we just make sure we get who we're dealing with here. This is in Isaiah. Mm-hmm. This is Yahweh speaking through Isaiah. This is not Isaiah on his own speaking. This is Yahweh through Isaiah speaking. Let that be clear. Read.
I'll start 18.
There you
Behold,
go.
Behold,
meaning watch and see. Behold, look at this. Understand this point from the prophet. Mm. Because it's by the prophets and the law that you're going to have to learn about something. Why? Because we know they are Yahshua. When he came in Matthew 5:17, he says he's not going to destroy the law or the prophets. Why is he going to make mention he's not going to destroy those things? Aaron brought it up or touched on it because he said we're going to need those things to learn about him. Right. Because he's going to be the fulfillment of the law and prophets. Mm-hmm. So we need to understand, we need to behold these things that Isaiah is talking about by way of Yahweh. Read.
Behold, I and the children whom Yahweh has given me are for signs and for wonders in Israel from Yahweh of hosts.
They say Gentiles. They didn't say any other people. These are chosen people, these
right.
Israelites, by way of Abraham.
That's right.
By way of Abraham's seed, by the promise given unto Abraham. And every other known religion admires and acknowledges Abraham. They want that promise. They want to know what that promise is. They're going to a physical land thinking he's going to come back in a physical some kind of way. We're expressing that it's not physical and that it is by the Spirit that we need to understand these mysteries, these wonders that, read what you just said.
Behold, I and the children whom Yahweh has given me.
Mm-hmm.
Are for signs and for wonders in Israel.
They're for signs and wonders. Starting from Abraham all the way down. Keep reading.
In Israel from Yahweh of hosts.
It's from Yahweh of hosts. From the Creator, from our Father. Read.
Which dwelleth in Mount Zion.
Mm-hmm.
And when they shall say unto you,
yep.
Seek unto them that have familiar spirits,
mm-hmm.
and unto wizards that peep and that mutter,
yep.
should not a people seek unto their Elohim?
Wasn't that a scripture reading in Titus? When they've been circumcised and they know the gospel, mm-hmm. but they want to deviate and go another place.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man. That's what our scripture reading was about, talking about the same thing, because they lost their way.
Right. Because
they don't want to speak according to the law and the prophets. Keep reading there in Isaiah, please.
For the living, should we inquire from the dead?
If we know the gospel, are we going to go speak to a Gentile that's dead, that's walking around and know not Yahweh, and they reside in darkness?
Mm-hmm.
We say we've been given a great teaching, and we're going to go talk to somebody else about the teaching that we've been bestowed by the light, by the true light that dwelleth in every man that know
that's heard the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah by way of the death, burial, and resurrection. But keep reading.
To the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word,
right,
it is because there is no light in them.
So when people talk in another religion and they want to express something to you about your creator, and they're going to talk to you about the New Testament, talk to you about Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, because it's written in ink that this is the gospel of Matthew and the gospel of John. Are you going to listen to that? Are you going to continue to listen to that? Or make up some other random individual as though that's going to be your savior? That's what Isaiah is talking about by way of Yahweh. Mm-hmm. And the Titus said, don't go that way. Stand fast in what you do know, by way of the law and the prophets, because there's no light in them. What? If there's no Elohim in them, right? That's what we said, this word in John 1 and 1, we expressed 1 and 2, it's talking about this was the light of the world.
That's right.
But if they're not going to speak to the Old Testament or to the scriptures, what light are they going to give you as a Gentile? Keep reading down there in Isaiah. What does it say if they don't know the scriptures or they don't speak by the law and the prophets? Read.
And they shall pass through it hard pressed and hungry.
Hard pressed and hungry. That's the principle by which they had to come down into Egypt, because they was hard pressed and hungry by way of a famine. Keep reading.
And it shall come to pass that when they shall be hungry, they will become hungry and curse their king and their deities and look upward for help.
That's what they say. He coming, God coming back from the ground, from the sky, and the Gentiles that don't know Yahweh, and we're supposed to go ask and speak to them about our Father? Are we going to make some other thing up that we've already been shown and taught by way of the law and the prophets?
Yeah.
But why we have to stand in that as Titus, as Saul told Titus to do? Isaiah is prophesying what we just read there in Titus 1. Then let him get to chapter 2.
Right.
So you understand that when we speak, we're going to use the law and the prophets. Right. We're going to use the whole book. Because the whole book is essential to know the law and prophets in order to get to know how Yahshua the Messiah fulfilled. Now we're going to work with Enoch translation a little bit. Read.
Genesis 5:22.
Mm-hmm.
And Enoch walked with Elohim after he begot Methuselah.
Enoch was the seventh from Adam.
Right.
Okay. Now we're going to read about what this is in the law that Moses wrote about. Read.
And he begot sons and daughters. Mm-hmm. And all the days of Enoch was 365 years.
Mm-hmm.
Enoch walked with Elohim, and he was not, for Elohim took him.
Mm-hmm. That's a translation by Sean Way that Enoch spoke the things of Yahweh Elohim and was favored in order to be translated before the death.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So that's where we got a translated state there specified in the law. Grab me 2 Kings there, please.
2 Kings 2:11. And it came to pass, as they still went on and talked, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire,
mm-hmm,
and horses of fire,
yeah,
and parted them both asunder.
Mm-hmm.
And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And Elisha saw it, and he cried, "My father, my father, the chariot of Israel, and the horsemen thereof." And he saw him no more.
Mm-hmm.
And he took hold of his own clothes, and rent them in two pieces.
Mm-hmm.
He took up also the mantle of Elijah that fell from him, and went back, and stood by the bank of Jordan. And he took the mantle of Elijah that fell from him,
yep,
and smote the waters, and said, "Where is Yahweh, the Elohim of Elijah?" And when he also had smitten the waters, they parted hither and thither. And Elisha went over. And when the sons of the prophets,
mm-hmm.
which were to view at Jericho, saw him, they said, "The spirit of Elijah doth rest, Elisha." And they came to meet
him. The spirit of Elijah does rest, right? Go back up a little ways there. And the horses of fire that parted.
And it came to pass, as they still went on and talked, and behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire,
mm-hmm.
and parted them both asunder.
Mm-hmm. And when Elijah went up by whirlwind, by the wheel of Israel, that was a translation. That's when Elijah was translated. That's why later on he said his son said that he rested, because Elijah had already translated. That's by way of a prophet prophesying there in 2 Kings about a translation that took place. And there's going to have to be a translation taking place in us by way of knowing the law and the prophets. And this is a event known as translation. We have with Enoch. Now we have it with Elijah. Get the next one, please. That's a law and prophets. Now we want the fulfillment of that. You got it?
Revelations 12 and 3.
No, I need Acts. You have the pamphlet there, right? The pamphlet, in the back of the pamphlet, you have translation. And in the translation, it shows you the law, prophets, and fulfillment. So I'm just going down the line with that pamphlet, the pink pamphlet. For anybody online that needs to know, it's the same one we worked with the other day. It's the clergy. Got it? See, Dr. Kelly is phenomenal in what he set up. It's all right here for us to partake if we pay attention and see how the law, the prophets, and the fulfillment solidifies who Yahshua the Messiah is. This is our faith that we're going to need to know and understand. Because what does it say? John 5:17. Eternal life is to know, right? So if we got to know something, we got to know about Yahshua the Messiah. And we have a book. And I just expressed, Isaiah just expressed by way of Yahweh, that we got to know the law and the prophets. And therefore, we got to know how to fulfill the law and the prophets for our understanding. That's the light of the world having manifested within the world. How he went down through the ages and dispensations is how we're going to live. Once we get the hold of the fundamental basics of the law and the prophets. Right? So we have that there? Genesis, and we just talked about the law, and we talked about the prophets based off of translation. And then we went Acts 1:9-10.
And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight.
That's Yahshua having been taken up after his death, after his death, burial, and resurrection. When he came back and appeared to them, now he's being taken up. Read.
And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel.
See, when he was taken up, that was his translation. He was fulfilling the translation of one Enoch and one Elijah. This is the purpose of why Yahshua is being taken up at this particular time. Read.
Which also, ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up in heaven? The same Yahshua, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Then returned they unto Jerusalem from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey.
Now, that's what that's the translation of Yahshua the Messiah did in fulfillment, because we know that there on the mount, when he said in Matthew 5:17, that he's come to fulfill and not to institute, right? And so now this is a fulfillment of what Enoch and Elijah experienced. Colossians 1:13, please.
Colossians 1:13. Mm-hmm. Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear son.
Translated us into the kingdom of his dear son, right? That's what knowing Yahshua will do for you when we understand law of prophets, the unity of the spirit, the death, burial, and resurrection, or the blood, water, spirit. Knowing these things in the particular order and the particular way that the founder has laid out for us in pamphlets, in books, in transcripts. Mm-hmm. And we have speakers all around the country and the world speaking the gospel of Yahshua the Messiah. Therefore, we are behooved, and we were behooved to learn as much as we can, right? This is a learning about translation, being translated from one state unto another. And we understand that Yahshua Messiah took off the flesh, right? And then he came back 50 days later and outpoured of the Holy Spirit upon those that he had taught, that knew of who he was, that did not leave their first estate.
Right.
And then that, by way of that spirit, he continued to teach them. He continued to show them the purpose. Give me Luke 24, 25, and then we're going to skip down to, I think, 44. Really, because I made this example. Because some people think that because of our Holy, they got the Holy Spirit, and it poured out on them, and they think that they were just the apostles, they have become apostles. They just knew everything.
24, mm-hmm. 25.
I think.
Then he said unto them.
Go up further. Go to 24 or whatever.
Okay.
This is the Messiah after he died on the cross and he resurrected, right? And he's starting his 40-day journey on earth after his death, read.
And certain of them which were with him went mm-hmm. to the sepulchre and mm-hmm. found it even so as the woman had said.
Right.
But him they saw not.
He resurrected, read.
Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart uh-huh. to believe all that the prophets have spoken.
See, we talk back to the prophets. They didn't believe the prophets. And they were fools for not having believed and stayed in the prophets, read.
Ought not the Messiah to have suffered uh-huh. these things and to enter into his glory?
Right.
And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
So it's the things that is reiterating what I've just said, that these charts are showing the proof of Yahshua the Messiah by way of the scriptures, which are the law and the prophets. You have in your book saying that the Messiah, after he's resurrected, appeared unto them in their consciousness, in their state of mind, because they were already disciples, but now he's going to have to bring these things back to their remembrance mm-hmm. by way of what? Moses and the prophets. Right? Keep reading.
You want me to go to 44?
Yes, 44 is fine.
44. Uh-huh. And he said unto them,
yes,
these are the words now, which I spake unto you.
Now he's with everybody now in the room. Mm-hmm. After he didn't walk on up to Emmaus, later on they keep walking on up to, I think it was Emmaus, and they're in the room gathered together. Read.
While I was yet with you,
yep.
that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses,
right.
and in the prophets, and in the Psalms concerning me.
He's the one that's fulfilling all those things. These are in, by way of the law and the prophets, and fulfillment. When we see how he fulfilled translation, we can see how he's our translation. Because when we read Colossians again, I think that's it for there, right? 44? Mm-hmm. That's it for 44. Now right. go back to Colossians one more time, please.
Colossians 1:13.
Uh-huh.
who has delivered us from the power of darkness
uh-huh.
and has translated us into the kingdom of his dear son.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
In whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins.
Redemption through his blood. Yeah, his blood on the cross here, right? And everybody wears their cross on their cross, on their chest or necklace or whatever, and they have this image, right? And this is the blood that they will speak about. But we now know that this blood is didn't start here. This was the fulfillment of the blood that started, one, down here at the Passover, the first Passover, correct? Where they had to take out a blood, take out a lamb on the 10th day and hold it over to the 14th day and slay the lamb. They had to use that blood from that innocent lamb without spot or blemish, strike it on the inside of the top of the doorpost, the two side posts, and dip it from the basin. This is our witness of an institution and what Yahshua Messiah fulfilled by way of Golgotha on this cross. That's the blood. And we see it on this we see it on this elementary chart here. Every story that we have depicts a spot of blood or death symbolizing his blood. And it's not just him on the cross. Mm-hmm. That was the fulfillment. That's why we say we were going to be a New Testament Christian. Can't just stay with the New Testament, within the New Testament, and think you're just going to believe. It's not blind faith. You have to have some. You can't have faith without some witnesses in something. You can't know something without experiencing something and seeing something for yourself by way of the scriptures, not of your own testimony, not of your own experiences, not of your own assumptions, right? Because we've talked about Isaiah 8 and 20, by the law and the prophets is what's going to give you light, right? You got Hebrews 12 and 22 or 23.
Hebrews 12, 22.
Mm-hmm.
But ye are come unto Mount Zion and unto the city of the living Elohim, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and congregation of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to Yahweh, the judge of all, and to the spirit of just men made perfect.
So we have in Hebrews, you come to the mount of transfiguration, or to the mount of understanding, or Zion of the living Elohim, the city. And that is the living Elohim, or the spirit that's come down by way of this Holy Spirit of understanding and learning about him in his perfectness and in his fulfilling what he's set up. I'm going to grab. Let's grab another one. Give me circumcision on page 40. Started Genesis 17.
There you go.
You're just grab them in order.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Genesis 17. Or Genesis 17. We'll pick them all up.
These things we've heard about, and but yet to be able to articulately express them become important. We understand it's like Aaron worked with the migration or the three trips here earlier of how in Exodus 19 you get when the Yahweh spoke down the Ten Commandment law to the children of Israel, right?
Mm-hmm.
And we understand that that was a marriage. If you get Exodus 24 and 1, you can see how he had to use blood in order to establish this first covenant on the book, on the vessel, on the vessels, and on the people. Everything was sprinkled with blood, and therefore, we read earlier about the blood of the Messiah. Well, that is that blood too. That's important to understand how this first covenant was instituted by way of this first trip, as Aaron talked about. Then on the second trip, in Exodus, the 24th chapter, we have Moses and the 70 elders seeing Yahweh Elohim. And then only Moses, by way of being invited up by Yahshua the Messiah, saw the 6 days. And then Aaron talked about, he saw the additional 33 days, he saw the structure and the function of this tabernacle pattern about how to put it together and to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. And it was within this tabernacle pattern by which Elohim was going to abide with within the midst of the children of Israel, because we understand that tents were set up when it was set up on all four sides of this tabernacle, right? And Yahweh, Elohim, typified by this tabernacle pattern in the midst of them, in order to lead them, right? Okay. And so this becomes a prevalent trip, and then that was on the 24th, and then I believe it's 34. You would read Moses' third trip when Moses was admonished to bring up the exact same tables of stones and to bring it back up into the mount in order for him to get a recapitulation of the 7 days and then on down to Yahshua the Messiah's death, as far as the genealogies and the pedigrees down to Yahshua the Messiah's death. It is this understanding that he had to come back down and put that stone, this first stone, which is the second stone, typifying that new covenant that's going to be put in our heart and mind. Because the first one he broke
right on
the second trip. That's symbolic of the first Ten Commandments and the 603 other laws, statutes, and judgments that was imposed upon the children of Israel. Mm-hmm. That's why he broke this tables of stone, mm-hmm. the first one. But the second one is indicative of the second covenant that we're going to read about in a little bit. But now we're going to talk about the circumcision, mm-hmm. because there was a circumcision going on at this time, understanding, hey, that Moses was circumcised, right? That's how Pharaoh's daughter knew that he was an Egyptian.
Right.
So you got a circumcision going on that we need to understand, because it's part of the Old Testament. It's part of the law. So now we're going to go to the law and find something out about a circumcision, about why it was imposed on the children of Israel and the children of Israel alone. Mm-hmm. Read.
Genesis 17. I'll start at 9.
That's fine.
And Elohim said unto Abraham, Thou shalt keep my covenant, thou and thy seed after thee in their generations. This is my covenant which ye shall keep between me and you and thy seed after thee.
That's Yahweh talking to Abraham, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what Moses wrote about. Keep reading.
Every man child among you shall be circumcised, and ye shall circumcise the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be a sign of the covenant betwixt me and you.
That's a sign of a covenant between Yahweh and Abraham, or the nation of people. No other Gentile, nobody else was spoken of at that time about that. You got Deuteronomy 16? Mm-hmm. This is what's set up, and this is what people, they say they want to follow, you know, the Ten Commandment laws. People say they want to adhere to what thus saith Jesus, as far as saying that he instituted these various ways of worshiping and to do these things. That's why even now in the medical field, people contend with one another, do we circumcise or not circumcise a child? They have, you know, there's a big contention about that. Mm-hmm. But that's not none of our issues. There's a hygienal issue based right. off of it. It's a personal preference, if you would. But according to the Bible, that was true for the Jews and the Jews alone, that this circumcision was being instituted. Read.
Deuteronomy 10 and 16.
Uh-huh.
Circumcise therefore the foreskin of your heart, and be no more stiff-necked.
Right.
For Yahweh your Elohim is a mighty El, and sovereign of sovereigns.
Yes.
A great El, mighty and terrible, which regardeth not persons, nor taketh bribes.
So this is Yahweh saying, circumcise your heart now, not the foreskin of your of your private part, right? This one now is going to, he's saying he's going to, you're going to have to do, this is what you're going to have to do, is circumcise your heart from the things that I've already imposed onto you, right? And get rid of that skin, because it's nothing but flesh. All that they did down here was all dedicated to animals, innocent sacrifices, day in and day out, in order to cleanse you of the of your ill doings, as far as breaking the laws and the sins, or committing sin based off the law that was given. They needed a physical sacrifice. That's the flesh. And therefore, we have a fleshly heart that we have to come into a knowledge about Yahshua the Messiah, so our heart can be circumcised, just as he set the example up for circumcision unto Abraham and all the children of Israel, right? Mm-hmm. Let's get it, let's find it here in the prophets. Read Jeremiah 4.
Jeremiah 4:4. Circumcise yourself to Yahweh.
Yes.
And take away the foreskins of your heart.
Okay.
Ye men of Judah and inhabitants of Jerusalem.
The foreskins of your heart is the first thing that you've come to know and love. What was first? The foreskin was the first part that you come to a reality about this world, that you fell in love with about this world. It was just based down here in Egypt, in darkness. You were told one thing or another before you came into the school to learn anything about your Heavenly Father. So this, that that information got to be circumcised of your heart, of what you believe and love in about Yahweh, because Yahweh is expressing it to Jeremiah, who's prophesying to do what? Read.
Circumcise yourself to Yahweh, okay, and take away the foreskins of your heart, ye men of Judah, inhabitants of Jerusalem, lest my fury come forth like fire and burn that none can quench it, because of the evil of your doings.
Because the evils of our doings, the wicked way, if you know not Yahweh, is going to be contrary to what he's expressing through the law and the prophets, by not knowing how Yahshua Messiah fulfilled those things. Give me Jeremiah 31:31, since I touched on this covenant real quick. Please.
Behold, the days come, saith Yahweh.
This is the prophet Jeremiah speaking. Read.
That I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah.
Okay.
Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt.
He's talking about this event here that Aaron went over earlier about having spent 400 years down here in Egypt in captivity of a land they knew not of. We were in a land in the world that we knew not of about why we were in it. That's why we went seeking after our Creator, after our Father, right? And now once we could have the ears and the eyes to see what this gospel is talking about, because it's by the foolishness of the gospel that you're going to be able to be delivered from this darkness. And when he got up here, he gave him a covenant to do. This is what Jeremiah is saying that she's going to do away with. Read.
Which my covenant they break.
They broke. Didn't Moses break this stone? Then he broke the covenant. That's an example of breaking that first covenant. Read.
Although I was a husband unto them, saith Yahweh.
Right.
But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith Yahweh. I will put my law in their inward
parts. Now, after those days, not these days, right? Because you have Moses having got brought back up on that third trip, he brought up a new tables of stone to be written in. And when he put that second table of stones in the ark, they carried that ark for 40 years here and another 1,500 years up here before it got lost and taken by being robbed right up here. But they had that second tables of stone for a long time up here in Canaan's land. It was revered unto the Jews, right? Even to this day, they're trying to restore this temple to put that stone back up in here. Right? And so what we're saying after those days was after the days of the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua the Messiah. That's going to reread what you just said.
But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, said Yahweh.
Mm-hmm.
I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts. And will be their Elohim, and they shall be my people.
That's the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. After those days, it's going to transpire, and that he's going to write it in their hearts and minds by way of the Holy Spirit. All right? Did we finish? So that's the prophet and the law about circumcision. And we just went over about this covenant. The first covenant being broken, and what the second covenant is going to have, how it's going to come into your heart and mind, without the foreskin of your wickedness, of your wicked ways. But you got to know something about Yahshua.
Luke.
Moses broke the table stone, but the people break the law.
They broke the law. Well, right. Right. With that, this breaking of the stone is symbolic also of them going to be breaking the law all the days while they're toiling with this first covenant. And this is why this first covenant was going to be removed and taken out of the way by Yahshua the Messiah. Right? So that's why it was broken. Mm-hmm. And it's going to be written in your heart and mind. Read Luke, please.
Luke 2:21.
Uh-huh.
And when 8 days were accomplished for the circumcising of the child, his name was called Yahshua.
Uh-huh.
Which was so named by the angel before he was conceived in the womb.
His name was already Yahshua before he was even conceived. His name was already Yahshua. All our names are already written before the creation of the world. So we're coming in the likeness and the image of Elohim. Just as it says there in Genesis 1:26. So that circumcision or the 8th day, he's not already going to have that done. Keep reading.
Mm-hmm. And when the days of her purification, according to the law of Moses, were accomplished, they brought him to Jerusalem.
That was accomplished. That was finished. Why? Because he's finishing the circumcision that was told unto Abraham to do. It was in the circumcision that Jeremiah talks about doing in the prophets. That circumcision on the 8th day of Yahshua the Messiah, because he lived, 33 and a half years, at 8 days old, he was circumcised in Bethlehem. He's conceived in Nazareth, born in Bethlehem, circumcised in Bethlehem, and then taken, raised up down in Egypt, right? That was the trek of Yahshua the Messiah. Again, threefold, right? So that's the principle of the circumcision that Yahshua the Messiah fulfilled of Abraham. Now let's go ahead and grab Colossians 2:11, and we'll be right out of here.
Colossians 2:11, in whom also ye are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands.
Made without hands now. This is the circumcision of understanding who Yahshua the Messiah is. And he is going to circumcise that stony heart. Or that heart that has that flesh that dwells and loves the earth plane.
Right.
Loves the flesh. Loves the worldly things and set their mind towards that. But it's by way of learning about Yahshua the Messiah that he's going to be able, like, as Aaron said beautifully, things it start breaking apart. Once your problems, I won't say go away, the ability to handle your problems become more sound,
right.
more stable-minded, even though you got the problems, but you're stable-minded way of learning about Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. That's what Aaron had talked about earlier when he talked about things will start, you won't be as affected by old situations that cause you problems, because now your stony heart or your fleshly heart is going to be eradicated by way of the circumcision without hands. Read.
2:11.
Yeah.
In putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of the Messiah.
See, the Messiah is going to be doing the circumcision. He's he's that two-edged sword that's going to be able to divide asunder the things within your consciousness and what's on your heart and mind. Keep reading.
Buried with him by baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of Yahweh.
It's the faith and the operation. We say that this tabernacle is a structure and function. It's an operation to come in this tabernacle into and perform the functions of this tabernacle to be at a certain place within this holy place to be able to see the structure and the function of the scriptures, of the law and the prophets, of the death, burial, and resurrection in order to give you comfort and faith. Keep reading. Is there any more there?
Who has raised him from the dead.
Raised him by way of the gospel, the preaching of the gospel. Read.
And you, being dead in your sins.
As we were, read.
And the uncircumcision of your flesh.
We were dead and not knowing about Yahshua the Messiah, put it that way. If we weren't dead by not performing these Ten Commandment laws, we were dead by not knowing who Yahshua the Messiah is. Keep reading.
Hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us.
To the Jews and Jews alone, but us as well, the things that we thought we knew about what God was about and what this was about, as Aaron talked about, but now coming into this gospel and learning about the names and about the structure and the function of the tabernacle and then death, burial, and resurrection and the law, prophets, and fulfillment. Read.
And took it out of the way, nailing it to his cross.
That's what he nailed to the cross, and that ended that portion of a time.
Now, I was going to say, did you want her to read Romans
2? Yeah, we can get that real quick.
Romans who?
Romans 2:28-29. For he is not a Jew which is one outwardly.
Okay.
Neither is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh.
That's what they had to do back here as Jews. That's why I said earlier, everything happening back here was as an example for us to look at for the Jews only. But now what?
But he is a Jew which is one inwardly. And circumcision is that of the heart in the spirit and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of Yahweh.
Hallelujah. If you got anything out of what was said this evening, all praises go to Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Love. That will conclude this evening's lecture. Thank you all for coming out with us and to study with us today. We have one quick announcement before we'd like to adjourn. We'd just like to acknowledge the passing of one of the brethren, Margaret Woody. That was, I believe, late Friday, previous Friday here. She's a member of the Pomona, California class, and our condolences here go out to the family of her and everybody out there in Pomona. So I just wanted to let you, anybody out there who may have known her, to know about that there. And you could send probably any correspondence or greetings, condolence cards over to the Pomona class. If there's no other announcements, we'll adjourn class. Okay? So we hold classes here every Tuesday and Thursday from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and every Sunday from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Please bring all your friends and enemies, because this is truly a place to learn something about your Creator.
for who he is and how he actually exists. Thank you to all of you who've joined us on Facebook and YouTube. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah.